Everyone, please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please, Mrs. Meltzer.
Thank you. Mr. Aragona.
Here.
Mr. Keyes.
Here.
Kapura.
Here.
Cannon?
Here.
Mrs. West?
Here.
Mr. Gillingham?
Here.
Mrs. Meltzer here.
Are there any additions and or deletions to tonight's agenda?
There are no deletions, but there are two add-ons. Item number 18, sale of surplus items, and item number 19, request authorization to attend conference.
So moved.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you, and welcome to your Township Board meeting this evening. If there's any item on the agenda you wish to speak to, please come to the podium as we address it and give us your name and address for the record, please. If there's something that you'd like to say that's not part of tonight's agenda, we have public comment cards to your left in the front of the room to fill out. So thank you, and with that, we'll take item number one. Request permission to hold annual parade on Friday, October 6th. From 4 till 5:30 p.m., Clintondale High School.
To whom it may concern, Clintondale High School would like permission to have their annual parade on Friday, October 6, 2017, from 4 p.m. to 5:30 p.m. A map is attached of the route that we will be taking. The theme this year is Masquerade Ball. Thank you in advance for your time. Sincerely, Alexander Taylor, CHS Student Congress Advisor.
Thank you. We have never had any issues with their parade.
Move to approve.
Thank you.
Support.
Supported by Mr. Keyes. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item two, a request approval to hold a parking lot sale with a 20 by 20 foot tent, Harbor Freight Tools.
I'm requesting to hold a parking lot sale for Harbor Freight Tools with a temporary tent for dates August 17th through August 20th, 2017. This is the same tent and dimensions 20 by 20 feet as our last parking lot sale held last June 2017, which was in compliance with township requirements. We look forward to having this matter added to the next township meeting agenda in August 14th. Thanks for your time with this matter. Sincerely, John Ostrowski, store manager for Harbor Freight Tools.
Thank you. We have never had any issues with their tents.
Let's move to approve.
Support.
Supported by Mr. Gillingham. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item three is request approval to host a fundraising dinner with a 60 by 140 foot tent, August 19th, Church of Christ Care Center.
Dear Ms. Meltzer, the Church of Christ Care Center is a nonprofit senior living community with Section 202 apartments, assisted living, and a skilled nursing facility located on 15 Mile Road, about a quarter mile west of Harper. We are once again hosting a fundraising dinner event on Saturday, August 19th, 2017, which includes dinner and entertainment for about 350 of our donors. There will be no alcohol and no fireworks at this event. We will have dinner together, then entertainment by dueling pianos. We wish to put up a temporary structure of a tent 60 feet by 140 feet for this event. The tent would be erected on Friday, August 18th, 2017, and will be removed on Monday, August 21st, 2017. The location of this tent will be in front of our assisted living in the paved event area located at 23621 15 Mile Road. No easements will be hindered by the tent. We'll keep our police and fire departments informed as the event date draws near. We ask that the Township Board approve our plans and give permission for the use of this tent. Thank you for your consideration. We hope to hear from you soon. Sincerely, Patti, Jenema, Public Relations Director.
It is recommended by the Building Department that we approve it, that we've dealt with them in the past and had no trouble.
Move to approve.
Support.
By Mrs. West, supported by Mr. Pearl. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item four is request permission to hold the inaugural Officer Collin Rose 2K9 Memorial Run and a 5K run at the Civic Center Park.
We seek permission to host the inaugural Officer Collin Rose 2K9 Memorial Run and 5K on November 18th, 2017 at Civic Center Park. Registration for the event will begin at 7:30 a.m. with a 9 a.m. race time. The event honors Collin Rose of the Wayne State University Police Department. He was killed in the line of duty on November 23, 2016. He was a member of the department's K-9 team and a participant in honor guard activities. Rose was rider in the annual Police Unity Tour. He was passionate about K-9 safety and was an active volunteer with the Detroit Dog Rescue. He is survived by his parents, Karen and Randy Rose, his brother, Curtis Rose, his fiance, Nikki Salgott, police dogs Clyde and Wolverine, and other loving family and countless friends. Rose is interred at Resurrection Cemetery near the Civic Center. A race registration fee of $28 includes a t-shirt. Supporters will hand out water at a relief station at the halfway point of the proposed route. Proceeds will support the Officer Collin Rose Memorial, which provides assistance in the following areas: financial support of the Wayne State University Police Department, K-9, and Honor Guard teams, financial support of participants in the annual Police Unity Tour Memorial Bicycle Ride, financial support of the first responder Sergeant Collin J. Rose Memorial Scholarship at Gull Lake Community Schools Foundation, financial support of K-9 safety organizations and the Collin Rose Enrichment Center at Detroit Dog Rescue. Organization also provides emotional and financial support to fellow line of duty death officers, survivors. The run will consist of two different routes. One is a 2K for dogs and their owners, while the other is a 5K for runners and walkers. Participants in the 2K will start the race and follow a separate route than 5K runners. All participants must sign a liability waiver, and all dogs must be licensed, vaccinated, and be social with other dogs and people. The proposed routes follow established footpaths and sidewalks and should not require any street closures. The proposed route for the 2K9 Memorial Run is as follows. The event will proceed as we will start at the northeast driveway to the Civic Center, continue north along the driveway to Canal Road, and follow the footpath to ROMEO Plank, and then follow the footpath south along ROMEO Plank to the south driveway of the parks. The route will then follow the driveway east into the parking lot, then north on the footpath to the roundabout in the footpath. The route continues east to the roundabout at the end of the footpath and back along the western footpath, then north along the footpath past the Little League Field and Dog Park and Senior Center. The route follows the driveway behind the township buildings and back into the main driveway where it concludes. A map of the proposed route is attached as Supplement A. The event will proceed as follows. We will start at the, this is for the 5K Memorial Run. So the event will proceed as follows. We will start at the northeast driveway to the Civic Center, continue north along the driveway, then go east along Canal Road, following the footpath to Clinton River Road and back to ROMEO Plank. The route will then follow the footpath south along ROMEO Plank to the south driveway of the park and continue east along the driveway onto the soccer fields, then north to the roundabout in the footpath, then west along the footpath, then north along the footpath past the Little League Field and Dog Park and Senior Center. The route follows the driveway behind the township buildings and back into the main driveway where it concludes. A map of the proposed route is attached as Supplement B. Thank you for your consideration. Chris Powell, co-worker of the late Collin Rose and chair of Officer Collin Rose Memorial.
Thank you.
That's me. I'm sorry for such a long, thank you.
It's good to, it seems long, but it's good to get it on the record and into the minutes. So don't apologize.
Address is 6050 Cass Avenue, Detroit.
And I know that you know one of our officers here in Clinton Township.
Two of them. Okay. Roxetti and Mark Hudbeck.
Yes.
They've been pretty active in helping me get things together.
Well, that's nice that you're doing this. It's a good cause, number one. And number two, it'll bring attention to what you're trying to bring attention to, the dogs and what they do. The only thing that I would suggest to our board is that we approve it, subject to the approval of our Parks and Rec director and DPS director approving of the route. But there may be some changes, positive changes, by the time the run occurs that will make it an even better event.
Mr. Keenan, could I ask a question?
Certainly.
Are all the dogs that participate in the 2K, are they going to be, is it going to be required that they have leashes?
Yeah, they would be running with a leash, and the registration that they would be agreeing to participate would have a waiver that they were licensed, vaccinated, and social with other dogs. And we'd have a spot within our registration thing to put down where the dog is registered for any out-of-towners.
Okay, and the they run in a way so that they're not interfacing during their run with the 5K runners?
Yeah, so I figured we'd do a staggered start. To have a staggered start, and that's why we would have the canines go out and go left, and then everybody else go out and go right a few minutes later to avoid any conflicts.
Okay, sorry. That's all.
Thank you. Further comments or questions of the board?
Yes. First of all, thank you for doing this. I mean, it's a nice honor to him. Do you have to run? Does the dog one, can that be a walk?
Yeah, it could be a walk. Okay. Like I said, we like the 2K thought because Collin had two dogs, and a 2K is kind of manageable for most canines to either walk or run.
Okay. I mean, I previously would have said I would have run it with the dog, but she tore her ACL this summer, so it's like kind of gimping along.
Yeah.
But by that time, she should be pretty good, but running's still not quite it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Further comments?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Thank you. Subject to the approval of our Parks and Rec Director.
Yes.
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 5, request permission to hold the Color Me Healthy Fun Run Walk on Saturday, September 30th from 9 till 11.
This family-focused fun event will be held on the campus of Henry Ford Macomb Hospital. The intended audience is employees and their families. It will be advertised internally only. This fun run walk is an untimed event for the purpose of bringing families to promote activity and healthy lifestyles. Runners will have an opportunity to stop at stations for healthy messages, and there will be a celebration area at the finish for water, grab-and-go, whole fruit, photo opportunities, and other fun, interactive teaching moments. We are planning on 100 participants. However, we may see less since this is our first time offering such an event. Color runners will be doused in powder paint at intervals throughout the walk that correspond to the Color Me Healthy colors. The fun factor is to start in white and finish in color. See attached map. This map outlines the walk route and the space that will be designated for the event. We do not anticipate using electricity. Canopy tents may be used at the registration area and stations if the weather is inclement. Bathroom facilities will be available in the adjoining HF Henry Ford MH buildings. 43421 Garfield, Healthier Way, Entranceway will be blocked off during this time, and vehicles will be directed to the alternate entrances. Ambulance and emergency vehicles will be notified ahead of time by Melissa Jackson, our emergency preparedness contact. And this letter was submitted by Jill Towner, your RN, for the community.
Thank you. And they're staying on their property, so they won't be in any roadways at all.
Right.
Hi there. Lauren McKenzie. My address is 46159 Rhodes from Macomb.
Thank you. Does anyone have any comments or questions?
Move to approve.
Support.
Support.
Thank you. Supported by Mrs. West. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 6, special land use, the tobacco shop at the Sunset Plaza.
This commission has held public hearing on the proposal for special land use, being a business selling tobacco, e-cigarettes, vapors, and related accessories in the B1 neighborhood business district on the subject property located east of Garfield, north of Canal, and has made review of the request. I hereby make recommendation for approval of the special land use to permit a business selling tobacco, e-cigarettes, vapors, related accessories in the B1 neighborhood business district, the tobacco shop at Sunset Plaza, subject to the following conditions. Number 1, must be 18 years of age or older to enter the facility. Number 2, the hours of operation are limited to between 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. on Mondays through Saturdays and between 10 a.m. and 5 p.m. on Sundays. Number 3, if it is determined by the police department or the building department that the business is allowing the admittance of persons under the age of 18 or distributing or furnishing the e-vapors, e-cigarettes, and or related accessories to those under the age of 18, or operating beyond the hours of 7 p.m., the violations will be subject to additional action with a first-time offense of $250, a second-time offense of $500, and a third-time offense being the revocation of the special land use permit, and any court costs, attorney fees related to the collection of these fines will be paid by the business owner. Item 4, there is to be no food served at the business. coffee, water, and/or tea can be served as complimentary beverages but are not to be sold. Item 5, all requirements of the Planning Department and Building Department must be met prior to the issuance of the Certificate of Occupancy. And item 6, the parking lot must be repaved within 30 days of receiving Township Board approval. This action was by unanimous vote. A copy of the notice of the June 8, 2017 public hearing containing legal description and a sketch of location of the land in question is attached for information and file. This matter was petitioned by Hanum Abro, 4048 West Point Court, Shelby Township, Michigan, 48316, as represented by Fatin Abro, same address. We submit this proposal for consideration and would appreciate advisement of your determination. Sincerely, Denise Trombley, Secretary for the Clinton Township Planning Commission.
Thank you. And the petitioners are here this evening. If there are any comments or questions of the board members. Yes. Gentlemen, could we ask you to come to the podium, please? And give us your name.
My name is Ganem Abro.
Thank you.
And Tanner Abro.
Thank you. Mr. Keyes.
Thank you. Thank you very much for coming in today. One of the questions I've had in the past for these types of developments or these types of businesses, in terms of the vape that is sold at the business, do you create that or is that something that you're purchasing from a vendor?
No, we purchase it from
a vendor. You purchase it. Okay. And then how do you plan on making sure that it's the individuals that come in are 18 years of age or older? Are you going to have someone at the door, or how do you plan on doing that?
We ID at the door, and we do have a sign right on the door that says under 18, not permitted.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Further comments or questions? The floor is open for a motion. I'll make a motion to approve of the business because it is a legal business that we hope you do a fine job there, but I don't approve of young people using your product. And I think my whole board believes that to be true also.
You're in your motion incorporating all the conditions.
All the conditions that we were read. Is there a support?
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Who supported it?
Mr. Aragona.
Okay. Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Mouser, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Good luck. Item 7, request approval of a Class C and SDM liquor license with a dance permit.
Dear board members, applicant CNC River House, Inc., located at 136 South River Road, Clinton Township, Michigan, 48036, has successfully fulfilled the requirements per the Building Department and Fire Department, as well as the police background check and payment of the application fees necessary to acquire a liquor license transfer. Based on this fulfillment of requirements, CNC River House, Inc. requests approval from this honorable board. Thank you for your attention to this matter. Sincerely, Kim Meltzer. All things are in order, and I can answer any questions.
Comments or questions?
Is the proprietor here?
I don't see him, no.
Mm-mm. That's too bad.
It's a lost opportunity to market, unfortunately, for people that come.
Exactly.
But, yeah, he did appear at my counter several times, so I'm aware of who he is and the process he took.
Move to approve.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Support.
Supported by Mr. Aragona. Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Mouser? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And item 8, presentation regarding records management.
Dear board members, our goal with this presentation is to go over the progress that has been made with our electronic content management system, LaserFiche. Since April 2017, we have successfully migrated 20,559 entries for billing and in excess of 120,000 entries for clerk. As you may recall, the supervisor's office was previously scanned, and they currently have a total of 145 entries. Entries do not equate to pages. They are files. One entry could be multiple pages, for example, board packets and minutes. Buildings entries are property records that were scanned from microfilm and are approximately one-third complete. The imaging vendor will be digitizing the remaining two-thirds over the course of this year. The clerk's office entries consist of burial permits, contracts, elections, insurance certificates, licenses, liquor committee, minutes, Board of Canvassers, Township Board, and Zoning Board of Appeals, oaths, board packets, ordinances, and resolutions. We are anticipating additional files from our scanning vendor this week and are imposing documents each day from our own scanning. Given the volume of paper and organization of the documents that need to happen before scanning, this historical importing takes time. Once those documents are in place, we will continue to import our current information as it comes in. In addition to building township information into our ECM system, we have successfully built several business processes that allow integration of departments working on licensing, and Stephanie will be speaking to that momentarily. We continue to encourage every department and committee to begin the inventory of their documents. Once inventory is complete, we can meet with you to discuss how you would like your files set up in Laserfiche so we can move forward to have them scanned and finally imported. If you have further questions, please let us know. Thank you, Kim Meltzer, Township Clerk. And if I can, just before they, before Stephanie starts, I just want to say that this is something we can now focus more diligently on because we don't have an election until probably the gubernatorial election in August of 2018. So this allows us, even though records management is a very important part of what we do in the township, elections always take priority, and the records management portion would be put on the back burner until we can focus, until elections are over. So now we are kind of looking forward to, well, we are grateful that we will have some time from elections to really focus on our electronic content management. And with that, Stephanie has stepped into the position, and she is our IT person that has done a great job in creating the workflows and the business processes, which are very complicated. And she's done a great job. And with that, through the chair, if she can get started.
Good evening, Stephanie Chung, 20725 Blinsky. What has happened since the last update that you had is that we've actually put, besides the repository and saving items in there, we've actually put a business process. The first one we wanted to kind of do is the licenses that happen with the clerk's office, because that is one of the ones that there's four of them that happen, and we thought it'd be an easy way to get all the departments involved, not every single one, but five departments to kind of initiate it. Sorry,
the space bar?
Yeah, it's not there. I didn't bring a mouse with me. Sorry about that.
Even a guru can have trouble.
Okay, and so and I got her there. Sorry about that. But I just was trying to give you a basic. The first slide is just a basic information of what Laserfiche forms are. It's not that the repository is an actual software where all of the records are stored. What I'm using here for the business license is a web application. We don't have it open to the portal, open to the public, but as of right now, it's able to send out the emails to the departments to request the inspections. And also, you can also put a link that we haven't really tested out with everyone yet, but if like a business were to ask before we even open the portal, we can send them that link. They can actually fill out the application, email back to us, and we can start the whole process. And this is just a little bit of information of what this forms allows you, which is, like I'm telling you, the web-based part of the Laserfiche that we've gotten. It's a business process. It's basically what every department, their daily activities, what they do, like issuing permits, you know, any of the transactions with Treasury Department. This can all be part of this. And also, it allows us to do automatic notifications through email. The workflows does that, too, and so does the forms. So once, like, if we have the applicants apply for the coin device licenses, we can let them know, yes, your form or your application was correct. We're sending it out. The inspectors will come out to do the inspections. And once they're approved, we can email those out to them. Instead of doing the whole paper process, we used to print it up, mail it out to them, contact them by phone. Now we can just do this all through email. And this is just the summary of what I kind of introduced you with that. There's four licenses that are annually renewed in the clerk's office, and these are the departments that are involved. The only one which we did the original test with the coin device, and the only department involved in that is the Treasury Department. The rest of them, they do the car wash, coin operated, and the used cars and the new cars. And this is just a summary, like, when a person would come in to do their application, it'd be printed out or handwritten, then it would take a day or two to actually put it into the system because we would have to Xerox copy it, scan it, and then make each individual copy for the departments or the, you know, like the four or five departments that are going to do the inspections. Then it would go through interoffice mail. So that took 1 or 2 days to process. Now with Laserfiche, when they come in, if they have it filled out or they don't have it filled out, we can actually put it in, and it takes about 2 minutes to actually go through the system. We look at it and then hit a button and goes to everybody. So the process time for that is down. Mm-hmm. The main thing that you don't see is the whole inspection time only went down maybe at the minimum 2 days, and that's because of inspections going out, like the building inspectors, the fire, it's their scheduling. But the ones that did come back faster were police and fire and also planning. So that day when they received them, actually received them back approved instead of waiting a day or two for the interoffice mail. So that was a cut down on that time significantly. So, and the other holdup you would have is there's any violations, especially with building or fire. So this also tracks it for you. So if I haven't received anything back in a couple days, whoever initiated the process, which I have done for this testing, you get an email saying you have tasks that are waiting, you know, to check the status. Or I can set those for a certain amount of time. If we wanted to eliminate the time frame, we can do that. And this is just an example of last year, you know, it was 1 to 2 days for the processing and when we get things back. And then your second one is right now telling you the duration. And that's, you know, sending out the inspectors was like 4 to 5 days. So it did cut down. And as I told you before, but this is just showing you the process time. That, you know, reviewing it, getting to the computer to actually type it in, look at it to make sure it was right, and then sending it out to everybody. And another thing with the forms that helped out is instead of having individual forms for everybody fill out for each separate license, we have one form that'll take care of all four licenses. And depending on what they pick, if it's a coin device, they can put it's a renewal, new, and then with coin device, it has, the pricing is different with how many machines you have. It will automatically fill it for the customer so they don't have to figure that out. And then also the other three are just based on being new or renewal, so it automatically fills that for them. And I just wanted to show you guys an example of in Laserfiche, like if you were to look up licenses and we wanted to see, you know, I have a Kunneth Brewery up there. Last year, their license is in there, and it was the old way of scanning it in afterwards. And so that's a tap form. So you can see the license issued, and all those little, you know, thumbnails are just everything that was turned back, handwritten. So you can't really see the information. So the new part is underneath, and if you actually just, you know, highlight over the new license, you actually can see all the returns back, and it tells you, yes, they're approved, or no, they weren't. So it's right there instead of having to open up the whole file. And this is just a basic layout of the repository. It just, not everything is in there yet. This is like the clerk's view. Like we could put the supervisor, it's just that we haven't been to every department to say, what do you want open to everybody yet? So like supervisors right now, they have some of the, you know, proclamations in there. So I could put that in there and they say, yeah, we want everybody to see that. We can open that up. Each individual file, we can put a security tab on it or limit who sees it or what only certain people or department heads. You can put every kind of limitation on there that you want. So, do you have any questions?
Thanks. Mr. Keyes?
Yeah, I just have some general questions. Going back from the original letter, this process was started back in July of 2014, I believe. So obviously I wasn't on the board and maybe a little bit of catch up. And a lot of my questions you answered, and so did that letter, so I appreciate that. And so just so I'm clear, what departments have been completed as of now?
Well, I believe we're still waiting for four boxes back from the graphic science from the clerk's office to put into there. And other than everything that we have on our drives or we had available to us is into Laserfiche. And we only have one-third, what the letter does state, one-third from back from the building department. And I know we've made contact, fire departments made contact with us because they want to move forward too. So it just, first thing I thought we could do is this form, because there's like we just did the coin, next month will be new cars, or used cars, I'm sorry. I just want them to, like, I have everything set up with all the clerks in building so they can look at it, get used to it, and tell me if that's really working for them or not, or what they think might improve their process to get faster. Because now, when we first got Laserfiche, you could do third-party applications in there. One of the big ones they didn't have totally usable was BSNA, which every department uses. And now they've been testing in Monroe, and it's been working where we can automatically, dynamically fill some of the forms out, which is going to make their process a lot easier.
And can you just explain to me the rationale of choosing those departments? I'm assuming that those departments work together in some way that kind of led you to...
Well, that's why I chose them, because of their part of the inspection. And that was the first one that was coming up while I was working on this with coin devices, so that's why I picked those four, to see how it could all integrate together and how they could work together. And also to see if I went to each department and explained it, if they understood it. And I mean, I was very surprised. I mean, I left the police department, and when I came back, it was already answered. So They did really well.
And so then, based on that description, so we have a third of the building department done, most of the clerk's office, you're just waiting on a couple boxes,
right.
And then at this time, the supervisor's office has everything done that they've requested.
I believe so. I mean, because they had that done prior to the last...
And so, and I think you just started to allude to this, but what are the next departments, these departments that are basically going to be the next phase?
Well, finishing building, and I, like I said, fire's already contacted, so they're ready, they really want to jump aboard, but I like to try to do assessing, because prior to me doing this form, I had talked to them, said, is there a process that might be easier for you to get you used to this? And it was one of the, like, the land split or combine where they had to go, they had to actually walk department to department to get it signed. So that'd be a nice step. And plus, I already have all the streets already put in there for building. We can actually put them in there.
So that's for assessing. What's the benefit for fire?
Well, they have all the reports, which they're doing by streets. And also, that'll, since we have that already in there, eventually I like to look where we have one action, depending on what they want out and what can be set out, one whole section made just on properties where we can combine everybody under that property. So, you know, like every single license, every building permit, every inspection, any kind of fire incident that can be open to everybody.
So it seems like kind of the protocol right now is looking at, we've already put this information in, now who else needs that information, and then we'll
keep
moving
on. Right, and since we have like streets set up already, just actually putting them in there and combining everybody else, because we have it set up so it'll merge a little easier, and just getting the feel of how it looks, and I mean, changing it if we have to or not. You know?
Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I don't know if this would be a question for you or for the board. You know, in terms of, at the end of the day, with the equipment, the staffing, the training, and things like that, how much have we spent on this project?
Right. We'd have to do a total. If you wanted to talk about the actual employees that have worked in it, we'd have to look at that. But the cost of the software, I think, was, what, $43,000, something like that. That's all it was for it. We did, and this was before you came, Mr. Keyes. We vetted all of the vendors. We sent out an RFP. We created the RFP. And so more than just, obtaining the electronic content management system, even though we went through all of that process, there's a lot of thinking that has to go into, and a lot of planning that has to go into an endeavor this size, because this is our hub. This is the foundation of where all of our repository, of where all of our documents will lie. And as a result, in addition to that, it's not just like some people think, oh, well, you know, we can just throw all that information in there. We can't do that. You have to index it. You have to inventory. Mm-hmm. And it's a very tedious job to do. And so this process has been evolving, and as I said, then when you have elections to have to stop. You know, it's like you have to come to a skid, start with your records management, and then proceed again with elections. That makes, you know, it's a stop and go type thing. However, we really feel we've made the right decision in purchasing Laserfiche. In fact, Oakland County that had OnBase, which I think is what Macomb County has. Do they have OnBase?
I don't know if they use OnBase.
Okay, I think they do. That's like the Cadillac of the systems. Very, very good system, but it's very costly as well. And
Oakland County had that system, and they just transferred to LaserFish. So I think they're seeing it as a more user-friendly system, and we're really glad that we went with this system. I think it's really going to benefit not only us internally and when we're doing licensing and permits and so on, but, you know, the goal was to get rid of those silos, to bring down those walls, and so we're all connected, so we're not having a duplication of records or a duplication of efforts, and we can all see everything that's ever been done to a piece of property. We can see it all under one screen, and it's all compiled, so it will save a lot of time. It is already saved, as you said, Stephanie, in your presentation, and you did a great job, by the way. Thank you. And so we're really excited about it. We're excited because we're now really starting to be able to spend a lot more time on it, and it's going well.
So just to clarify, though, I'm sorry, it's $43,000 for the last 3 years, or is it $43,000 per year?
No.
And then
in total.
The total for 3 year, mm-hmm. is a three-year contract?
Yeah.
And so do we know what the cost will be moving forward? Is it just a continual 3 years for $43,000?
No, I don't. I know we're talking about upgrading to a 11.1, which it hasn't come out yet. With that, they will have the ability, I don't know if you can talk to that more techie.
Well, no, I mean, we're going to also, with this basic form that we had so many licenses and upgrading, we're going to have more licenses for the department. Mm-hmm. And then.
And there's a cost associated with that. Yeah. And then Rio. As a point, right now we have Avante. So a Rio is a higher, it allows more. I'm sorry, I said
no, take it away, and then
I took it back from you.
No, like you said, it's just an upgraded version where more add-ons are actually thrown into it, like most products are like that. So.
And is it a similar upgrade to what you've been talking about here, where that wasn't an additional cost, or the
no,
upgrade would come
that's
with
that's what we had, and anything that they additionally they did. It's just, there's technically like two ways of going. You could go all with the workflows or a business process, and I kind of went more with the business process because that it was easier for, not every station had to get the download of the repository, but it was easy for them to actually just get online and do it. But, you know, within our intranet, our, you know, local VPN right there. So, but in talking to you about how she's talking about the duplication, I just wanted to mention that, like, one of the challenges that came up were a building department had condos where the whole microfilm that they were doing was several addresses. And they were saying, well, do we have to do every single address separately? And that would take up more space. Mm-hmm. But with LaserFish and how the repository is set up, we could actually break that up into shortcuts. So we only have it saved in there one time, but they have several shortcuts with different addresses. So it looks like they're separated, but it's just one information. You're not taking so much space up. Mm-hmm. So.
I saw that Mr. Pearl had a question. I can yield my time for now.
Mr. Pearl.
Sure. Just a couple questions. When we originally started this out, I asked how we were going to save the data, and I was told on a server located off-site. Is that still true? Who can answer that?
Well, the backup system is off-site, yeah. Which is how all, you know, IT has it set up, that they do have backup.
So it's our servers locally?
Right, and then, you know, your backup system, they have located different locations within the township.
With the new system, though, the 11.1, I think it's all cloud-based, right?
Yes.
But we would still have backup, though, mm-hmm. right? Yeah.
Is it backed up every day?
Yes.
So if the servers were corrupted locally, that data would be somewhere else?
Correct, and then they go from the last download or the last backup to come back so you don't lose so much data. That's why it's done daily.
Yeah, because I have a small business, and that's the way we do
right,
it daily.
Right, it's too much information to lose.
Yeah, and yeah. Imagine the amount of documents you're putting in. We don't want to ever
yes,
lose it.
It's a lot.
And we don't want to do that work more than one time.
You're saying that they're going to eventually also go to the cloud with it?
They do have it out, but it's so new that, you know, you want to kind of have it out there before we take it on, so all the bugs are kind of worked out, or the major bugs. We don't want to take it when it's brand new and have something like that.
So IT is the one directing the backup?
Yes.
So they're, and we're sure it's being done, and it's
and also,
with the company.
And also, I mean, there's also were instances where we weren't sure about how something was saved, and calling the vendor, they also check the backup and can bring some things back for you, too. And they have done that. Like a form had been lost, and they were able to find that. This is like when we first started a couple years ago.
So you're allowing the public access through forums, which...
Well, not yet, yeah. But I mean, it's possible.
Businesses.
Right. And like if they were to request, you know, I need a form to do, you know, a used car, I can send them that link. And what that form I showed you, the new form, how it looks, that's what will pop up in front of them. Doesn't mean they have access to any of our computers or to our system. They fill it out, send it back to us. We get the email, and it automatically starts our business process on our end.
Okay, but they're not actually going to be on our server. Sending them a link.
Right, and it's just an email, basically. So it opens up a form that looks like what we have on the internet right now, but it's our new form.
And then they have to send it back by email.
They just hit submit, okay. And it automatically just comes right back to us. So they don't have to do too much. They just have to fill out their regular information.
Yeah. I don't want to tell you what it cost me for mine. It was $25 a month, but that's just for five forms.
No, yeah, so...
But yeah, they have that out there, and so people can fill out applications and then send them, and then when they hit the button, it's emailed to me.
Right.
So you're doing the same thing on a much larger scale.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Cannon, can I just interject really question? Sure. Just so you know, too, there's a lot of municipalities that don't do workflows. I mean, we are pretty, I think, cutting edge on implementing this type of priority, and... many of them just use Laserfiche as a repository. We're taking it a big step further, where we're actually creating workflows and business processes so that we know the genesis of how things were done. And it'll be easier, I think, for the employees to be able to say, how did this happen? Where did these documents come from? And how are they connected? So I like that we're not just, some people have said, oh, well, why don't you just send that out and have somebody else do it? It's not that simple. Anybody that goes, you know, we give our documentation to, we have to put our trust that they even know how we operate. Mm-hmm. And there's nobody better to implement this system, I think, than our employees. So I think Stephanie has done a great job stepping into this system, this process.
And just going on what you said, too, I mean, some of the things that are coming in, after we have them, you know, scanned in and we're looking at them, we're like, you know, the way they index it, it's not just right. So, I mean, kind of like every day, I've made a different workflow just to change the wording or do something. So, I mean, we have that ability to do that every day. And just, I forgot to mention, a lot of the stuff we have scanned in are on CDs. So that's another backup we have, too, so we don't lose everything that we've put in. So.
Thank you. Mrs. West?
Thank you. When we were talking about cost, wasn't there, and I don't know who I want to give this to, weren't there some specific costs, though, too, for the departments? Like building had, I thought, a fairly sizable cost for entering all of the information. Is that correct?
And that's what we're talking about, the one-third that came back.
Yeah. That was the graphic sciences.
Right.
That was, I think, Kim, do you have any? 20-some thousand for that. That's from their department.
Only for one-third of it?
That was for all of it.
But we only have one-third back right now.
And that's the microfilm.
Right.
Okay. Getting that on a PDF. And that's an important part of information to capture, because microfilm is really great, and it's true for any of the information that we put in. There has got to be a quality control assessment done on all these documents that come in. And you can imagine how tedious that is. I mean, these are millions. In the end, it's going to be millions of pieces of document that we have to review to make sure the quality control is there. There was one point when I first was elected 3 or 4 years back, there was a lawsuit that there was a request for information on microfilm. Well, then we pulled the information, we were able to find it, but when we opened it up, you couldn't read it. So the actual quality of the microfilm wasn't the microfilm itself. It was that however they transferred it onto microfilm, it didn't get placed on there properly, so it didn't get captured. And so in that regard, we lost that opportunity in a legal manner. Not that it, I don't know that it hurt us or not, but that's one of the responsibilities of the clerk's office is that we are the keeper of all records. So we want to make sure, in addition to, getting this work done, that it's done right.
Right, right. Well, kind of back to the cost. Will we end up getting something on, like, how much all of this is going to be? Because, I mean, you said the 43, and now we got the 20. On other big departments, how much will that be for, what's the name of the place that does it?
Graphic Sciences.
Right, yeah.
So that was a quote, there was an RFP, so okay. There will be an additional one which the board approves. So all of this information you guys have had in the past
right.
and have approved. Anything that we make going forward, any requests that we need, any documentation, again, we'll follow the RFP process. It'll come to the board for approval so you know exactly what we're spending and on the what.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Gilliam?
So through the chair to you, Stephanie, mm-hmm. thank you for being yes. here tonight.
Good job.
To kind of give us a sense as to what we're doing moving forward.
Right.
As you said, you stepped into it. I wonder if that's sort of how you feel on a, you know, a daily basis. we are, we're 3 years in here to this project, and we had hired somebody, we raised the salary to get them because they were the person with the most amount of experience on this. We paid for the certification, and we're 3 years into this project, and it appears we have one department done, the supervisor's office, which is 145 entries, a ton of records in the clerk's office, which of course makes sense, and we're almost done there. Mm-hmm. Is that correct? Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
Plus we did the business processes.
Right.
I mean, that's a huge...
So how are these things going to flow and how are they going to integrate? Okay,
right.
I want to get there because...
We completed one whole, you know, the coin devices had expired in July, and we actually completed the whole cycle going out to the departments.
So the 120,000 records, these are like the board agenda packets
yes.
from years past. What else? Are there previous business licenses, things of that nature?
Well, the ones that we had scanned in already, which you saw that one... 2016, like when I started doing the senior staff secretary, so I started scanning everything in to our share drive. So that's in there right now.
Okay.
A lot of the archives.
I'm sorry, not to interrupt, but Kim, you have a good handle on the specific, if you want to speak to it too. I mean,
yeah, I just want to get a sense mm-hmm. as to how this is.
So minutes, I believe, are from 1939 until current.
Wow.
Packets are from 1950s to current. We have ordinances in there. I'm working on those still. Resolutions.
Were they handwritten or were they?
Some of the minutes were,
okay.
yeah.
All right.
So those are eventually, what we're going to do is we have to have somebody actually read those minutes and type them into another section in LaserFiche so that they're searchable.
Okay.
So that's going to take some time. So
that requires the indexing part of it. That's the part of it that
right.
we're saying, okay, we need something
kind of
so we can search by this or search by that. Or
right.
Okay.
And there's several ways of searching. You know, you can search in just a certain section. You can just search in a certain section or on words. Like if you knew a resolution had a certain sentence in it, you can search on that, and it should bring you up all the close hits on that. That's why what's taking so long, like you can't just copy and paste and drop it in there, because you want it indexed, you want it OCR'd, and if there's an image, it's trying to pick up any wording it can, and that's what makes your searches better for you.
So who's doing the scanning here?
Well, it depends.
Well, Graphic Sciences is doing a lot of the historical stuff that we were able to send out, and...
Graphic Sciences is a private company?
Right. And that's where that $23,000 okay. came in for a building.
We approved all
they
that.
They bid.
We did.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, but I'm trying to get a sense as to. Okay.
So Graphic Sciences is finishing up with the clerk's office stuff. We're just waiting for some of that to come back in. And
so we gave these huge volume of records over to this company and said, here, get these in. But then as they're getting them in, we're having to figure out how we index them and what they're...
No. What we did was we sent them over and we said, this is how we want them to be named. So, for example, our minutes are 2017... 08-14. And then
okay.
it says Township Board regular meeting minutes.
So sort them by date and get them scanned
right.
in. So then we can get them online and people can search them.
Right, right.
Okay.
And same thing with packets, same naming like thing.
And so
for every single thing, we went down and we talked with them and we said, this is what we want. We want ordinance number and then the ordinance name. So they were sending that over that way.
So then while that's happening, then also there's this process of workflows where something needs to go to multiple departments for approval, and so you're figuring out how to...
So that's something totally different. I'm only really kind of handling the scanning of everything and getting that in. Stephanie's doing the business processes of getting the licenses routed.
Right, but that's the workflow stake
right.
part of it, right, that you were referring to.
And
okay.
The forms, but also with the scanning and it being indexed, it comes in, that's just the title. So you have a form, a template, that has all your metadata in there, because it's telling you the ordinance number and the ordinance, but there's information in there that you also want, like the day of the adoption, which is not in the title.
Yeah.
So that's, I'm making workflows or a business process to actually grab that information and put it in there. So you have those better searches.
I'm trying to understand, but I'm also trying to balance how deep we want to dive here in a, you know, board meeting. But the other aspect of this is, how is this going to interact with, like you mentioned, the assessing department? There's a lot of symmetry between the assessing department. They determine our valuations, which then determines, you know, how much people wind up paying. But we're all BSNA, and every department is BSNA. And so how is this interacting with BSNA? Because we have already paid for all this software at BSNA that has every address and records, assessing records attached to that individual parcel.
Right. And then you know, information that you're going to be working with assessing that you want, we can build a form or a template, whatever the specific process that you're doing at the time. So if you're working with a certain address, you know, you go by a parcel number.
Mm-hmm.
You can automatically, because we have capture as part of our LaserFiche, automatically put the parcel number in there, and it's going to grab all the information from BSNA and fill out the form for you already of what you're looking for to, you know, accomplish that business process that you're doing or that, you know, stuff that you're doing with assessing or which is your department alone.
I'm sorry, just because I don't know if she answered it. In your presentation, you said we are integrated now with BSNA, so we do have that integration capability. So,
can we just take a data dump from BSNA and dump it right into
BSNA? Is not a repository, so we had hoped that when we were looking at
We can also do with that capture, which is like an add-on to our you know LaserFiche or feature. If there's certain information on your form that you're filling out in BSNA that you need to fill out in BSNA, you can take information out of our repository and automatically fill it in there, dynamically fill in the spaces in there, so you don't have to sit there and fill a form out every single time. That can also be done. It's like vice versa. You can do either way.
Okay. So I think this is an incredibly valuable project, and I think it's something that absolutely needs to be done, and it's going to be valuable. But at the time when we were proposing this back in 2014, it was, this is going to save us money, but we can't really quantify how much it's going to save. Mm-hmm. But it's going to be a time savings. It's going to be other things. Beyond being able to quantify it, I don't think there was a real plan at the start of it. And so one of the things that I said at the time was, should we be hiring a consultant or an employee? The consultant to develop a plan, then hire somebody to implement that plan? Or should we be hiring somebody to develop the plan and then implement the plan? Most local governments that I've seen that have done this have hired somebody to come up with and develop a plan for how they're going to do this, then hired somebody to implement it, and then had somebody working with the departments to say, okay, we need this and this and this and this from you. So now we're in this, and you're sort of picking up the pieces here. So we appreciate the work that you're doing to that end. I think we need to figure out, one, how much money have we spent on this up to this point? I think the software figure was actually like $51,000. Then I think we have to take a look at the vendor cost of scanning all of these records in. Then I think, if I'm correct, I think we paid for the training for the previous employee to go on, which was kind of pricey, I think.
And Stephanie, too. You went to one of the trainings in California. We can get all of that information for you. That's not a problem at all.
So then what are the actual physical licenses going to be for all of these different departments? Because there's going to be added cost to that. If you figure the previous employee for the last 20 months, and I think we upped the salary, so it's around 70-something thousand, add 20% because of fringes, we're talking probably right now with the software, we're into this for probably, I'd say, at least $250,000.
I don't think we're that much at all. But even if we are, you're disregarding the value that we just expressed, how important it is for
the employee. I mentioned that value. Okay. I did mention that.
Well, I know, but you're simply saying it's only, should we, you know, we didn't have to send it out because, quite frankly, we discussed it in our office. We did not have to send out for a consultant. We in our office decided, what is the vision? What is it? I mean, me personally, I knew exactly, this is after going to a Right after I was elected, I went to a meeting, a convention for the clerks, and I saw what the potential was, and, you know, these electronic content management vendors were there. So it was based on me bringing that information back to my office, and we had a discussion, and we said, this is what we want. And actually, Kim Irvine even said this is something she thought was long overdue in the clerk's office, and she was really excited to be on board with it. So we had a vision, and we had a plan, and we executed that. We did not pay a consultant because we didn't need to. We knew what we wanted to do, and we are executing it, and we are doing, you know, a great job. And we are, I mean, it is, it's not an easy, it's very labor intensive, but we welcome it. And there's three of us working on it right now, and that's it.
Yeah.
You know,
I'd like to sort of reclaim, because I think if we actually pull the numbers, and I think it's important for the board to know how much money we've put into it up to this point, but that gets me to where I'm going. We're $250,000 into this, and I think that's somewhat of a conservative figure, actually. If you add up all the vendors, all of the salary, all of the software cost, all of the hardware cost, all of the staff time, I think you're well into that conservatively. And then we're going to be having additional cost, and we asked for a plan. I think I asked for the plan when Ms. Baranski came in and did the update, because there were, and to be commended, there were periodic updates to this. And, you know, she came in and did a report and said, okay, this is where we're at now, and this is where we're at now. She was doing that before the board. But there was never any sort of, okay, this is our start date, this is what we believe to be our completion date, this is what we think our total budget is for this project. And let's face it, it's an involved project, but it's a project. Right. And every project in the township is subject to public scrutiny, and so therefore needs to have cost figures associated with it. And this has been, from the very beginning, open-ended and no real end in sight. And the fact that we're 3 years into it, having spent the money that we spent, I want to see some figures as to where we're going, what it's going to cost us to get there.
That's not a problem. I can get you that information. It's very simple to get. And it is, it's going to stay an open-ended, I'll be honest with you. We talked about that before we even decided to get an electronic content management system, because we knew it's always going to be a work in progress. And it is something that, you know, as technology increases, we may or may not want to get involved in upgrades, but I see an advantage of having our employees do it versus having, you know, a software company say, okay, now you need this. Well, we know what we need. We may not need that upgrade. We may be able to survive with what, you know, because we've implemented all that information. So, but to answer your concern about a defined cost, you get those costs every step of the way. They have to be approved by this board, and they have been. And along with that, there was an explanation as to why we needed those costs. They were always budgeted. And so there's been no surprises along the way. I appreciate you wanting to know, like, an end date. There isn't one. Because we are always receiving documentation. We are always, it's a very dynamic process. And the initial costs are always going to be more than the maintenance cost. But there are maintenance costs associated with it. We talked about that. And those costs will go up. On an average, I think it's 3% every contract. But that could change too, and that, you know, we could be at the mercy of the vendor for that. But then when we get to that road, that's a crossroad, we decide what we're going to do next. But it's all, you know, very transparent, and it's up to this board to decide that. Not up to me individually, but this board, and we have had that process every step of the way.
I certainly agree that there's probably not an end date in sight, but there's got to be a phase date to say, we're, you know, here to this phase, here to this phase. We're always going to be accumulating records, so this is always going to be a continuous process. I absolutely get that, and there are going to be costs, and indeed, the costs were disclosed to the board, and they were brought before the board and approved by the board. But it's been sort of a very incremental type of process. And there's no sort of estimate to say, this is our project, these are our costs associated with this project, this is what we anticipate in this phase, in this phase, in this phase. And I think it really has to be managed like that, because we can't just say, oh, now there's this and this and this, and we're going to be putting this on this board agenda at this date, and you know, we'll see if the board wants to continue or they want to stop. I don't think we can make decisions like that. I think we have to be a little bit more
I would hope so.
Process driven.
Yeah, I would hope we wouldn't do it that way.
I'm just thinking like
that's
phase
the way we've
one,
been doing it, though.
It has not been the way we've been doing it at all.
Phase one, we want to get historical documents in. And so that's where we're at. We're trying to get everything in clerk's office. We're going to start working with planning, assessing, you know, everybody to try to get that phase done. It's millions of pieces of paper, millions.
Yeah.
So it's going to take a while to get it in. So.
Well, again, I appreciate all of the work that you are doing, and so thank you
just,
for...
Just so that you know, like moving forward, like how we said, started working with building, I mean, I already have created a main template for them, so any other new stuff, and I set up a drive, had IT set up a drive for them, and telling them, start scanning your stuff now, you know, so we can start moving forward with this. And there was one aspect that they, you know, and I talked to them individually, and they said one thing that they thought hindered them with their process is contractor's license, because BSNA won't handle it. So we've set up a whole new template for them, a whole new, you know, drive for them to actually put those in separately, and I'm starting a table for them so that they can automatically, you know, do, you know, dynamic filling out their every single permit instead of asking every single contractor every time they come in for all their stuff. And it's going to have the cutoff date so they know when they're expired, and they have everything right there for them. I mean, we are doing that moving forward, so that's not going to be additional cost. It's already part of it.
Okay. Again, thank you all for the work you're doing.
Mrs. West?
Okay.
Mr. Pearl?
Just a quick one. I presume after we're scanning everything, we're just putting it back right now. So we still have physical records in the vault and everything?
We do.
Okay. And the people that are using and implementing this, are there ground rules on who has accessibility?
Yes. We're going to set that up. We're going to set that up because everybody, I think, should be able to have access to board packets and minutes. Burial permits, does everybody need to have access to that? Probably not. You know, ordinances, everybody could have access to that. You know.
Okay, and then is it set up on a protected basis where it's read-only?
Yes.
Certain things. You can't change a form.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, good. I just want to make
sure. And that's what, I mean, either...
I'm sure they thought of this.
No, but I mean, you can set up your folders that way or security tags on them. So if you want a department head to be able to redact information, they can. I mean, there's all different ways of setting up every little thing that's seen or can
But nothing
change.
Can be altered.
Exactly. And then everything that's put in there, I have it as right now, I changed it to where it's a tracking system. So if anything does get changed, I can see where it's been tracked and it can go back to the original version. Mm-hmm. So we always have that original version, the true copy.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Good work.
Thank you. A motion to receive and file is in order. And
I can.
We have one more question.
Dave, if you don't mind. I think in all due respect to like what Paul has asked, et cetera, because I mean, there is... You know, these incremental. I'm just wondering. I mean, you know, I've been in hospital work for years with huge, you know, medical records, and brought the Henry Ford Hospital up when they did Project Genesis. Should there be a major push, you know, bring some part-time people in to get all this stuff in, get it in, mm-hmm. get it done, and then you're just putting in the new stuff? Is it something you've looked at, and is that something that you would, you know, want to do and bring towards the, not that I want to spend more money, I mean, that's not my point, but.
So right now, what we're trying to do is have the vendor, our scanning vendor, get us everything that they can, and we're getting that in. To have somebody else come in right now and try to help us, they kind of have to know what is what. Like I was explaining it to somebody else earlier, it's like trying to put the pieces of a puzzle together mm-hmm. to have a complete file. For example, SADs. I know what I need to keep, and I know how long I have to keep it, so I want to make sure I have all of those pieces of the puzzle.
Yeah.
It'll be intensive to train somebody on those kind of thing, those kinds of things.
But instead, we go to an outside company that's going to charge us.
No,
more?
No, no.
Or I mean, they
no,
don't do it.
Okay. No, they're not do doing it. That. What the goal is, and it has always been, is we organize it and send it to them. We get it back and put it in.
We do quality control first on it.
We organize it, we send it to them, and then we get
they
it back,
scan
and then
it.
We do it.
Put we, it and we put import it, it. We get it we put in.
Oh, so they do the scanning.
Right.
They just scan okay.
They send a file.
Okay. Is there, though, it may be, that's file. What I'm saying, is it better to bring somebody in, at least for the scanning? I mean, something where you have it lowers costs, but you get it in possibly faster. Think about
for
it.
Half
just
of
think
a cent
about
a page.
You know, think
probably
about
not
it.
Not worth it. I mean, it.
We have done that analysis. Mm-hmm. We've right. measured
I mean,
that
I'm even looking at, I mean, this could be an IT college, whatever. I mean, there's a lot of people out there who do this. I mean, medical records does this on a regular basis. I mean, switch over all of Henry Ford Macomb,
right.
You know, stuff in 1 month. Every medical record and put in their electronic medical. It was a nightmare, but mm-hmm. we did it.
Right.
So.
And the files were probably already all organized and ready to go.
Mm-mm.
No.
Mm.
We're kind of in the same boat. Mm-hmm. You know, they are, but they aren't. You know, we know where everything is at, and we know what needs to go in there. We just have, like, little notes
right.
that don't need to go in.
Right.
Why
right.
pay to scan that?
Thank you.
Mr. Keyes, just if I could.
No, Mr. Oh. Keyes is next.
I noticed that they're in personal vacancy review. We have a position for records analysis, and I'm wondering what that individual would be doing and how that would be a part of this process.
So the records analyst position is basically working for the implementation of processes and getting things done in Laserfiche. It's not going to be the records management part of it. That's why there's a drop in pay. And from what we've determined, Kim and I, because we know the documents, and we're going to go ahead and we have to do the quality control, we're taking that position, and we're not filling it at this time because we feel like we can do it. It's a lot of work. We've got time in between now and the next election to get this, you know, to get a lot of this done. In no way will we be done by the election, but we can get a lot of direction and things implemented before we fill that records management position. I feel that we're in a good position to do that, save the township money, and that's why I'd rather just work on the IT part of it. The IT, Kim and I really don't have a whole lot of background in that. Stephanie is actually working on a bachelor's degree and will finish shortly in this area, and that's why she's worked so well and done such a good job for us. We're very lucky to have her in our department, so it kind of worked out well.
I'm sorry, I'm a little confused. So this, you're not going to fill this position, or you're not filling the?
We're filling the. We're
getting a
qualifying
record.
It as a records analyst position is what we want to do, because they're not going to be that person. That position is not going to be doing the records management part of it. Kim and I are doing that.
Okay.
We're taking on that responsibility. So there's no cost.
So
extra cost to the township.
So this is going to be a new. Brand new position.
The new position, yeah.
New position.
Introduced a personnel vacancy, and then it'll go through civil service, and it's going to be vetted, and then it'll come back here.
And I don't mean to belabor the point, but has Stephanie's position changed, or are you working out of class?
Out of class.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We don't want the union after us, so.
No.
Okay. Well, I'm anxious to hear a personnel vacancy review about that position. So,
Mr. Gillingham?
No, that was it. So, I mean, is Stephanie going to be filling the position that was held by the previous employer?
We'll see.
Okay.
That's not
right.
a determination.
But we're
that
not
we
even
make.
Filling the records management position.
Okay.
So this is a new position.
So we'll have a new position that Stephanie will fill.
We don't know.
She has a test.
Okay.
We don't get to know that.
Okay. And then, but we are hiring a new person.
They'll be tested. There's a test that's being created right now. That's gone to civil service.
Okay.
A job description. They have to approve that first, and then based on their determination, we'll determine what direction we can move in.
Okay, so I'm just trying to figure out what costs we're working in, what salary costs we're working into this particular project,
That's not been determined
okay,
yet.
Okay, great. Okay, thanks.
Okay. All righty. A motion is in order to receive and file a report.
So moved.
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Gillham.
Yes.
Mr. Argona.
Yes.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes. Thank you, ladies. Great job.
Thank you.
Second. Item 9, bid award, Little Mac Water Main Replacement and Paving.
Dear board members, on August 8th, 2017, the Clinton Township Clerk received and processed a total of 6 bids for the above-referenced project. The total bid amounts were recorded and a detailed bid tabulation was prepared. A copy of the bid tabulation's project budget and a apportionment of the as-bid cost-sharing amounts are attached for your review. The apparent low bidder for the Little Mac Avenue Paving and Water Main Replacement was Paymar Enterprises, Inc., with a total bid of $1,193,729. As a condition of the bid requirements, prospective bidders were required to be pre-qualified for water main replacement in an existing residential or community developed area and horizontal directional drilling for water main or low pressure sewers prior to the bid opening. Paymar Enterprises, Inc. provided the necessary pre-qualification information to be considered for bid award. The paving subcontractor for this work meets the qualification requirements for the Macomb County Department of Roads. The bid results were reviewed with the Department of Public Services. Based on these conditions, we are recommending that the board approve one motion to award the Little Mac Avenue Paving and Water Main Replacement to Paymar Enterprises, Inc. in the amount of $1,193,729. Please review this information and feel free to contact me with any questions. Respectfully, Giffels Webster, Scott Chabot, Senior Project Manager.
Yeah, this is a fabulous project for the area. They not only get a new road, they get a new water line.
Yes.
Move to approve.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Argona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 10, approval of appointment to systems analyst position, information technology.
Dear members of the board, the information technology department is recommending the appointment of Mr. Shea Tomkevich to the position of systems analyst. This appointment constitutes a promotion to a higher classification within the department. Based on interviews, the department is confident that Mr. Tomkevich is well qualified for the position. The starting salary will be $63,904. Upon township board approval, the appointment will be effective August 15, 2017. Thank you for your consideration of this matter. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions?
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Just real quickly, it's escaping my memory. Did we already approve the budget amendment for this position? This would be a higher salary than currently.
I don't know the answer to that.
I don't recall. I'm not sure. I think we did. I thought we had done that first, didn't we?
Yeah.
I think we did.
Okay. Okay.
Do you want me to call you tomorrow?
It'll be done at a later point in the year.
Okay. And then I just want to actually thank Shay, one of our employees. He helped me out with one of the requests earlier in the week. He went ahead and took the applications that residents submit online and made them text fillable. So now residents can go in, type in the responses, print it out, or email it in. So now maybe a little easier for us to read.
God, he's a very qualified employee.
Yeah,
this helps with the workflows today.
Yeah. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a support?
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Argona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 11, approval of the appointment to assistant foreman position in public services.
Dear members of the board, the public services department is recommending the appointment of Mr. Mitchell Varellin to the position of assistant foreman in the facilities and operations division. This appointment constitutes a promotion to a higher classification within the department. Based on civil service testing and interviews, the department is confident that Mr. Varellin is well qualified for the position. The starting salary will be $60,197. Upon township board approval, the appointment will be effective August 15th, 2017. Thank you for your consideration of this matter. Sincerely, William Smith, Human Resources Director.
Thank you.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Argona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 12, approval for balcony replacement at Heritage Estates.
Dear Board members, the Heritage Estates Committee has met on several occasions to discuss replacement of balconies and exterior doors at Heritage Estates. This project in its entirety will be significant and substantial using new composite materials on the balcony. The committee originally sought bids to rebuild and repair 20 balcony units and replace exterior doors off the balcony. A bid award did not occur because the low bidder would not extend the start date beyond 90 days so that the installation could start in the spring of 2017. The Heritage Estates Committee reached out to all bidders to see if they would provide a quote for the installation of a single unit as a test case so the outcome could be studied. None of the bidders submitted a proposal to do work on a single unit, so further quotes were requested from other contractors. Jarvis Property Restoration provided the low quote for a single unit in the amount of $6,798 for labor and materials. The entire scope of work to be done is attached for your review. I have conferred with our township attorney, Mr. Dolan, as to how to proceed with the impending replacement of balconies and exterior doors at Heritage Estates. He concurs that completing a single unit to study the installation of new composite materials makes sense and that no obligation to award the previously bid for 20 balconies and exterior doors exists in favor of prior bidders. I therefore request the board to approve the recommendation to proceed with replacement of a single balcony and exterior doors with work to be completed by Jarvis Restoration in the amount of $6,798. This project will be paid for out of the Senior Housing Fund. Thank you for your consideration of this recommendation. Sincerely, Kenneth Pearl, Chairman, Heritage Estates Committee.
Mr. Pearl, do you want to add anything to it? It's pretty explanatory. You want to do a test case to see how it looks and see how it works?
Yeah, we're doing replacing the top boards on each balcony, but they're going to provide a new system composite that'll wrap around a soffit and seal the boards that form the floor. So the outriggers that come right through the building that support each balcony, we want to seal that in a way that the water will not penetrate it any longer. It's been exposed for 25 years to the elements without any sealing or anything. This will be a system that would not require maintenance, but we want to make sure, since it's a new system, that it sheds water properly off the balconies and that it ties together and flashes properly. And we want this is also going to tie in with the door wall, which is like a French door with one fixed glass and one open. And then there's a door for the mechanical room, which is exterior. So all that will be changed at the same time and flashed in. Yeah.
So then after you put it in, you'll take a look at it?
And then we'll bid it out again. Eventually, once we come up with a plan that the board can address, because the bonds are going to be paid off for this complex in November, I've requested a proposal from our bonding attorneys and our Miller Canfield to bring to the board to address what we should do and what we can do legally with monies that are generated once the bonds are paid off. So if we're going to do a project of this magnitude, we want to make sure because if you do all the balconies, you're looking at probably 200 out of the 300 are pet balconies. So you could talk at $1 million.
Yep.
Okay. So I want it all together so we know what we're doing and we know which way the board wants to go with the Heritage Estates in the future.
I like the idea of a test case, sort of a litmus test, see where we're going with this. My only question is, who's the lucky resident? Did you do a raffle?
Well, there's 10 balconies that they've looked at, and they're going to pick the worst. And then then anything that needs to be done on the other 9, if it's replacing one board or whatever, they'll do so that they're safe. But the staff has picked out 10 that are the worst balconies that need repair, and then we'll pick out one out of those 10. It's not a lottery.
Further comments? Floor is open for a motion.
So moved.
Support.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mr. Argona.
Yes.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer. Yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And then item 13 is request approval to attend training for the police chief.
Dear board members, I'm requesting board approval to attend the annual in-state 2017 FBI Fall Conference, September 6th to the 8th. This training is hosted by the Federal Bureau of Investigation and is one of the three training seminars I will be attending this year. I'm on the curriculum committee and will have additional responsibilities during the conference. I am budgeted to attend this worthwhile training. Thank you for your prompt consideration in this matter. Sincerely, Fred Postavis, Chief of Police.
Thank you.
May I ask, Chief, where is it? Oh, okay. Thank you.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Support.
Support. Supported by Mr. Gillingham. Before we vote, there's two announcements I'd like to make about the police department. The first is, congratulations, Chief, on your capture of the criminal the other day on the theft of over $100,000, and you trapped him and got them off the street in a very timely manner. We're very proud of what you did, and also the rest of your staff. So that way, we can vote yes on your trip here. Actually, we talked at the staff meeting. You probably don't need any more training. You've got all that you need. But we're glad to send you. And the second is, there are people out in the community now trying to scam some of our businesses with security cameras. We've tried to get letters out to all the businesses that do need these security cameras based on our ordinance. As many of you know, we're the only community in the state that's requiring this. Most of the businesses are very happy about this, but some businesses don't need security cameras. So we have people out there trying to sell to bakeries, to workout facilities, and to businesses that do not need these security cameras. So I believe Captain Marley was able to talk to one or two of the people that I consider scamming, because they're selling things to people that don't need them. So we're trying to get out as much public service announcement as we can about this. The other businesses have been notified that they need the security cameras, and they need them in by October 1st. And we will visit with them and talk to them and explain the benefits of the security cameras. In fact, the other day, there was a shooting in front of Anthony B's, and Anthony and I had talked several times about his security cameras, and he wasn't really for it, but he was going to do it, and he has them. And he was so happy he had the camera the other day because he got all five shots on film. And that's going to help in the police investigation. It's security for the person themselves, it's security for the business, it's security for their customers, and it protects and helps our police and fire departments. But we only want those businesses that need it to have to buy it. So please, if you don't know if you need it or not, take a look at that ordinance number or call the police department or call us, and we will help identify if you're one of those businesses that need it. Okay, with that, roll call, please.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And then item 14, request approval to sell four police vehicles.
Dear board members, I respectfully request to sell three of our police-owned vehicles. The vehicles no longer meet our departmental needs. We will be following the township policy and procedure for selling township property. I recommend to the board to permit the cars to be auctioned off at Motor City Auction in Roseville. They charge a flat fee of $100 per car sold. Two of the vehicles are Ford Crown Victorias, and the third is a Chevrolet Tahoe. Sincerely, Fred Postavis, Chief of Police.
Okay, I said four, but it's really three.
It says four on the agenda.
Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
Motion to approve the sale of three vehicles.
Yeah,
I don't know how that got on there. Sorry. All right, who made the motion? Joey? Or you, Mr. Gillingham, I mean?
And I supported it.
No, that's okay.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Okay. Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And then item 15 is appointment to Compensation Committee.
Dear board members, as required by Ordinance 430, which was adopted by the board at the July 24th, 2017 regular board meeting, I present for your consideration five candidates to serve on the Compensation Commission: Sherman Cottingham, William Greca, James Noak, Pamela Schlaff, Catherine M. Voss. Background information for each candidate are attached for your review, and I ask the board to approve the candidates listed above. Sincerely, Robert Cannon, Supervisor.
Thank you. And each of these persons will be assigned a number from 1 to 5, how many years they're appointed for. I have no recommendation as to that. You could do it in alphabetical order, which is the way they're listed, or we could just have them draw numbers at the first meeting they have. But the first meeting has to take place this year, and they can meet no more than 15 times in a calendar year, and 45 days after the first meeting, they will make a determination and bring it to the board. The board, of course, makes the final approval of any recommendation coming from the committee. I will ask Mr. Smith to sit and work with the committee to set up the first meeting date. There will be a chairperson elected from the five that are recommended. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Keyes?
Just as an explanation to residents and those that applied, I did vote no on this commission, and I'm going to continue to vote no on items related to the commission. It's just my personal opinion right now that the residents are not as concerned with the salary or possible raises for elected officials. They're more concerned with results from committees like the Road Committee and funding things in this township that they truly care about. So just as an explanation to both residents and those that applied, I wanted to offer an explanation.
Thank you. Is there a motion to approve? I'll make a motion to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Argona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
No.
Mrs. West?
No.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you.
Mr. Cannon, I just want to make sure we're clear on an item. Your motion as made is to approve all of the named individuals.
Yes,
correct?
Yes.
With respect, though, to the terms of office, you had presented several options, and I'm not sure, I just want to make sure as the motion was presented and voted on, whether one of those options you perceive as being included or whether we now need to make a second motion to clarify how the selection of the term will occur.
I would have no criteria as far as assigning the number of years, so I would hope that they would just draw numbers at the first meeting and assign it to that person.
Okay, well, I think we need to, I don't think
I'll
we
make
can
that
leave
a motion.
It up to them. I think we have to make a motion.
Okay, I'll make that a motion that five numbers be assigned to years served at the first meeting to be drawn at the same time that they will elect among themselves a chairperson. Do you support that, Mr. Pearl?
Yeah, I'll support that. Just a comment, since everyone's making comments about this. I support the Compensation Commission because I think they should look at the full-timers, but I'm not interested in looking for any increase as a trustee, and I wouldn't accept it if they did it. But I respect the full-timers' ability to keep. They haven't got a raise in 10 years, I believe.
Actually, it's 2004.
Yeah. Okay, longer.
Mr. Cannon, and again, I don't mean to interrupt, but so that the public's aware of how that works, an elected official can, in effect, refuse to take a pay that's been approved for that position. What they can do if they choose to is after they receive it, they can donate all or a portion back.
Correct.
And does this go for next term, any increase, or is it retroactive? Is it
never retroactive?
No, not retroactive. I mean, does it take effect at the time the board adopts it, or is it for the next term?
It depends on the resolution that's passed by the Compensation Commission.
Okay.
All right. Case.
And I just wanted to clarify, Mr. Dolan, can you explain, it really is not up to this board to approve it, correct? It would really be up to this board to deny it.
Correct.
Correct. Not deny, but to reject.
Or to reject.
You basically, as a body, have the ability to accept the recommendation. Well, what you're really doing, if you reject it, then the pay remains the same. Otherwise, if you don't do anything, then it's implemented. You don't have, for example, the ability to reach some sort of compromise in between what's recommended by the local officials' compensation committee and nothing.
And so if the committee was to offer a recommendation and then it was not voted on by this board, it would go into effect?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, roll call, please.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Argona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
No.
Mrs. West?
No.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Messer, yes, motion passes.
Thank you. Thank you for those who have volunteered their time. Item 16, resolution to repeal House Bill 4244 regarding fireworks.
Dear members of the Clinton Township Board of Trustees, during a recent meeting of the Macomb Area Communities for Regional Opportunities, or MACRO, members discussed the ongoing issues related to the legalization of commercial fireworks sales in the state of Michigan, House Bill 4244 and resulting Michigan Public Act 256 of 2011. Members of MACRO unanimously agreed to support a resolution demanding that state legislators repeal House Bill 4244 and the striking of Public Act 256 of 2011 for, in part, the following reasons. Number one, limited local control of fireworks regulations. Number two, increased related nuisance to include, but not limited to, noise, air quality, debris, and defiance of time and date limit ordinances. Number three, increased 9/11 call activity, risk of injury, death, and property damage, thereby taxing local municipal services such as police, fire, and public works departments and placing undue stress and anxiety upon residents. Number four, inability to enforce local and state laws related to commercial fireworks discharge. Number five, negative impact on veterans suffering from PTSD. Number six, negative impacts on our pets. The members of MACRO have asked me to reach out to each local governing councils or boards and respectfully request that they pass resolutions or send letters of support to your state legislators demanding the repeal of House Bill 4244. With your support, we can bring peace back to all of our communities. Thank you for your consideration. With kind regards, Dennis E. Champagne, Chairman.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes. Mr. Aragona?
No.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 17, discussion regarding replacement of liquor license committee members.
Dear Board of Trustees, the previous Board of Trustees had created a liquor license policy committee consisting of Treasurer William Sowerby, Clerk Kim Meltzer, and Trustee Paul Gillingham. With the change in position of Paul Gillingham to Treasurer and the vacant position left by former Treasurer William Sowerby, I'm requesting approval by this board to reappoint Clerk Kim Meltzer and Treasurer Paul Gillingham and fill the vacant position left by William Sowerby with a third member of the Board of Trustees. I appreciate your attention to this request. Sincerely, Kim Meltzer. And if I could speak to that?
Yes.
Okay. So just so there's a little bit of history, when this committee was first put together, it was done by the previous board, as I said in the letter, and it was a very informal process because it was part of a board meeting, and as a result of what was going on with liquor licensing and the changing with the state of Michigan, taking that responsibility from the locals. Once again, we wanted to also update the policy that had existed, it hadn't changed in many years, and then address how we were going to manage the fact that now the state of Michigan had taken on the responsibility, and yet we still held the liability, if you will, of what kind of activity could result from this type of, you know, licensing. So that was just as a, you know, it just by chance happened at a board meeting, which we've done that before. And however, the reason I'm bringing it forward now is because there's one issue that is quota licensing that has come to me from a business owner. We don't really have an answer on how to manage this. And what happened is a petitioner for a quota license did in the previous administration was rejected and wanted to, you know, and not just that particular person, but anybody that comes to the board, we don't really have any language in place to determine whether or not they would have to pay that process again. Right now they do, but it hardly seems like we already have all the information. We've done the background check, and yes, we'd have to do an update, but the amount of labor that's involved in the process, I'm not so sure qualifies as a cost as a new application. So that's kind of what I'm looking to put the committee back together to discuss. And with that, I have asked the two new board members if they were interested in the position. And I did receive a resume from Mr. Aragona
and I've given that to you at this time. And he does have extensive legislative experience with the state. I don't know if you want to speak to that, Mr. Aragona, or not, but he has worked for Representative Tony Forlini, who worked directly with LARA, which is the Licensing and Regulatory Affairs. So I think he would make a, he'd fill that position quite well. And
Mrs. West?
Does Mr. Aragona want to speak to that? Or?
Yeah, sure. I just was going to expound upon that a little bit. Liquor Control Commission, of course, sits underneath LARA. When I first started working for former Representative Forlini, he was the chairman of the LARA budget at the state. And I actually have worked pretty closely with two of the commissioners for the Liquor Control Commission, both the chairman and former Representative Brad Jacobson. So I thought this was an interesting committee to be on. If the board is so moved, I'm more than happy to serve on it. So.
Thank you. Joe, nothing against you. It does sound like your credentials are very good, but I would have appreciated an ask. Because right now, I probably have a little more time than you do. I mean, you're up there 3 days a week, at least, and driving back and forth, and I'm not. I'm here. And as a senior trustee, I would very much like to be to look at that. And, you know, we've talked about this for, 13 years that I've been on the board? Mm-hmm. And know a lot about the quota licensing, especially in the Groesbeck corridor, where people wanted to do that. And I'm very interested in being there, but I don't want to, I don't have, can my resume is not.
I just, well, I and this is the first time hearing of it, Mrs. West, and I would.
You didn't even put it out there, though, Kim.
Well, it was on the agenda.
It was on the agenda to be talked about.
Yeah, we're talking about it right now.
Okay, then I'm throwing my name in the ring, okay?
Okay, that's fine. But I'd like to make a motion to add, to appoint Mr. Joseph Aragona for that position. I think it would be, I think with his credentials, he would be, you know.
Along with you and Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Okay. Is there support? I'll support that. Further discussion? Mr. Keyes?
I'm just looking to see if the motion maker and supporter would be willing to make the appointments of Mr. Gillingham and Mrs. West, and then maybe at the next meeting, with a little bit more notice, we can make the third appointment.
He's asking you.
No, actually, so you're saying that you don't want me on the committee? Is that what you're
No, no. I'm saying we should make the appointment of Mr. Gillingham and yourself. So that way we have some notice on who the third person would be. We could discuss it at the next, or we could vote on it at the next meeting.
I'm not willing to do that. I know this is just, I mean, really, like I said, this was a very informal process when it was first created. This committee really is only probably just going to meet for that issue. It's not that big of a deal, except that he does, you know, Mr. Aragona does have the credentials. He did submit his resume. I asked you to submit your resume. I didn't get one from you. And we do have your credentials, Mrs. West, and I just figured if anybody was interested on it, they would have, you know, at least talked with me about it, especially since I'm the one requesting it. So I still stand with...
It says here discussion regarding.
Exactly,
and it doesn't say anything here that you were looking to make it at Mr. Aragona, or that you asked the two new people.
Right.
Should you have put it out to all of us?
No,
maybe
I only asked...
Maybe Mr. Pearl wanted to be on it.
Well, the thing is this, if that were the case, I figure you guys would have let me know. You've been on the board for, you know, you said 13 years. So if you had been interested, I think you would have brought it to my attention. And the only reason that I asked for the resumes of the new trustees is because they are new and, you know, may not have the information necessary to make a decision. So that was the only reason. And that was, you know, I think it's helpful to have that information. So
I called the clerk and told her I wasn't interested.
Mr. Cannon.
I saw it on the agenda.
Sarah Aragona?
I was wondering if Mrs. West and then the motion maker and the other motion maker, would you be willing to do an alternate position?
Well, maybe to share it, because if you can't make it, if you're out of town.
Sure. So the alternate position,
you're
then,
up there 3 days a week and coming back for a meeting.
I don't
or
think it meets...
It doesn't meet. There is no designated time. It meets.
That's,
it's just as need,
good
as needed.
So if we want to do an alternate position,
I don't.
That?
If we share it, that's fine.
Okay.
Okay. I'm open to making that adjustment to the motion. Are you?
Willing to support that, Mr. Cannon?
I would, but.
Okay.
Mr. Gillingham has a comment.
Yeah. I just want to, when I first got on the board as a trustee, I was sort of the driving force and impetus for this committee being developed in the first place, because I read through all of the materials. I looked at the disjointed process that we had, looked at the fact that indeed it is correct that the state has pulled a lot of the authority from us, but we are left with a residual benefit, or the residual benefits and the residual negative issues related to enforcing liquor control within the community. And so we made significant changes to this process, including upping the fee, but the real impetus was the fact that it was a quota license, and quota licenses are something that the state grants the community for the sole purpose of economic development within the community. But we do believe that there does need to be a full vetting process. And so we changed the application. We tightened it up. We cleared a lot of things up. I think the committee actually did quite a bit of work. It seems like we're doing this and re-energizing the committee for the specific reason of accommodating one request, if I heard that correctly. So it gives me a little bit of room for pause, but I'm obviously willing and able to serve on the committee and very interested. And so out of respect for Ms. West's time on the board and her commitment to the community, I want to make a motion to appoint Ms. Meltzer, myself, and Ms. West as the members of the committee.
We already have a motion on the floor.
There's been a, just so
it's an amended
to keep track
motion.
Of keep track of where we are in a from a stand. We started out with a motion to appoint the two full-time officials, clerk and treasurer, and Mr. Aragona. Subsequent to that, there was an amendment offered by Ms. Meltzer, joined in by Mr. Cannon, where the position would be basically Mr. Aragona and Ms. West as alternate, with the understanding that if he was unavailable, she would fill the position, as I understand it. And I think that's,
yes,
I believe that's
vice versa.
Beg your pardon?
Or vice versa.
Right. Correct. I think that's where we are now. So we now have an original motion made with an amendment. So we have an amended motion before the board.
That's correct.
And my motion is a substitute of that, which to appoint those three members as stated as members of the committee.
So you're making a motion to further amend the already amended motion.
And we're not going to accept that. He can't just throw out another motion after a motion's been made.
Well, he's moving to amend the existing
motion. He can amend it, but do you have a second?
Second.
Let's vote on it.
Okay, roll call.
Mr. Gillingham.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
No.
Mr. Pearl.
No.
Mr. Cannon.
No.
Mrs. West.
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, no. Motion fails.
Go back to the original motion, please.
Back to the amended motion.
Amended motion, roll call.
I'm sorry, question? To clarify the current motion, it was said by Joey or Mrs. West that it's or vice versa is the
no.
motion.
No,
it's not. It's she's the
Aragona,
alternate.
She's a substitute if one of the three is not available.
One of the three. Yeah. And then just a further question. I just want to say again, I won't be supporting this, and it's not that I don't think you're qualified. The reason being is I just don't appreciate this the way we make appointments. In the past, we've had the names of the individuals that were going to be appointed. I agree with Mrs. West that reading this agenda item says that we're going to have a discussion about it. And we're going to appoint two people, and we'll have a discussion on who that third person is going to be. It sounds like, again, that we're starting to vamp up this committee for a specific reason. And so what I'd like to do, again, is say that I caution us to just let's make the first two appointments, and then we can make the third appointment at a later meeting. And that doesn't mean it can't be Mr. Aragona, but I think that in respect to both the members of this board, but then also out of respect for the members of the public that view these packets at home and count on the information provided, that we don't just change things up at the last minute.
I disagree. The word replacement is clearly right in the item discussion regarding replacement. So roll call.
Sir, wait, in all due respect, and regarding replacement. It doesn't say, and I reached out to the two young ones for their new people for their resume. It doesn't say I contacted others. It doesn't say, please call me if you're interested. It doesn't say any of that. And you know what, Joe, in all due respect to you, I mean, awesome credentials. I'm not at all, but I think I'm going to pull my alternate. I'm not going to be a has-been. I'm not going to be a second thought. It's either, I'm just, anyway, pull it.
We're going to do a roll call. Mr. Gilliam?
So it appears to me, like I said, this is a committee that was formed for the sole purpose of waiving the fee for an applicant for a free liquor license, which sells on the open market for about $30,000 to $40,000 now. I think the members were selected because there was discussion about that. I didn't know why we were meeting again, why we were invigorating this committee, why we were having to appoint somebody, but it appears that we've already predetermined who we are appointing to the committee.
To that point, you and I, Mr. Gilliam, had a conversation, and I asked you, are you interested in being on this committee? And you asked me why, and I said, because of the quota, there's a new perspective on the quotas. We've never identified. I talked to Mr. Dolan about that, and he said, well, we don't really have a procedure for this type of request. So all I'm saying is that doesn't mean that, you know, that request is going to be granted. It only means that we need to have a policy to address it. And that's what I wanted you involved, because you've been around on the committee in the past. And then from that committee, we can make a recommendation to address the part of that policy that we never did in the previous administration.
I suspect this is going to be a tremendous benefit for an applicant.
Okay. Roll call,
excuse
please.
Excuse me. Yeah. Mr. Cannon, I wasn't part of this discussion that you're alluding to. I was just asked if I had the time to be on another committee, and I didn't at this time. There was no other discussion. All I was told is that we were filling the position because of Mr. Sowerby moving to the state rep position. But in regards to discussion, I don't know why we would have to continue another discussion later. Everybody stated who wants to be on it. Everybody has stated, you know, their reasons. And I think we can make a decision, yes or no. I don't know why we'd have to wait. What would happen differently? You know,
what do you mean? What would happen?
In other words, if we waited to another meeting, so what?
That's not the motion on the floor.
We're voting.
I don't know why you're talking about waiting. It's not the motion.
I know. That's not the motion. But there was talk about another motion about waiting to another meeting to discuss this again.
I see.
Okay. We're discussing it right now.
Mr. Cannon, I think because, and Mr. Dillon, maybe you can correct me on this, but I think because Joey has withdrawn her willingness to be on the committee, that we're back to the original motion, and that was to appoint Joey Aragona as...
Well, the motion as framed still has her being appointed as an alternate. So if you want to go back to the original motion, you would just, again, have to amend your... make a motion to amend to return to the original form of the motion, and you need support of it.
Well, doesn't it just automatically drop because there is no person that wants to be?
No.
Okay. All right.
The letter basically says reappoint Meltzer, Gilliam, and fill the vacant position. So we just need to have somebody make a motion to appoint three people.
Mrs. Meltzer, you have the floor.
I think.
Okay. Mrs. Meltzer. So, wait a minute. I want to make sure the amendment.
Just make a new motion.
You've got a motion in a second that's before you that something has to be done with.
So
what she can do is she can simply, this is another amendment to withdraw the part of the motion that has an alternate. So you're back to the original motion as it was originally proposed, which is Mr. Aragona and Mr. Gilliam and Ms. Meltzer.
I'll make that motion.
And I'll support that.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Mr. Cannon.
I still have a question.
Okay.
So I'm just to clarify, based on what Mr. Pearl had just said, you were asked to be on the committee and let them know that you didn't have the time. I was asked, Mr. Aragona was asked, but Mrs. West was not asked.
Was not.
So we're selecting individuals and giving them information while keeping other board members
out. I made an attempt to reach out to Mrs. West, and I was unable to reach her, and that's been the case in the past by phone. But
I have nothing on there.
It's okay. It's okay. It's fine anyway.
You know how to get a hold of me.
No. There's been many times I've tried to reach you, and I can't reach you.
If I see Kim Meltzer has called, I call you back.
It's happened many occasions.
I have not gotten any phone calls from you.
It doesn't matter anyways. You had enough information here. Honestly, Joey, if you wanted to be on it, you could have let me know.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Keyes,
with me still having the floor, I just want to remind these board members that the business of this township happens in this boardroom.
Right.
It's not about a phone call or a text message or an email. It happens in this boardroom.
Correct.
And when we tell residents that we're going to have a discussion on it, we should have a discussion and then give them a proper time to know that we're going to have a vote. That's why we don't do this. This is why when we have appointments.
He's right, though. So he is exactly right.
No, we do all types of work outside of this
board. That's fine. If you can correct me, what is the last appointment that we made of this board where we didn't have the individual's name prior to walking into this boardroom? What was the position?
Mr. Cannon, if I can speak to that, I just explained how we did it the last time in the previous administration. We didn't even have it on the agenda. It just arose from a conversation that this board had. So it's that, you know, I took the formal approach. I let everybody know it's not an add-on. It was put on there. It says regarding appointment to Liquor License Policy Committee. You know, I'm not going to spoon. No, the discussion has happened. We have had the discussion. And I said to you, based on this submission of Mr. Aragona's resume, and I did ask I texted Mr. Keyes and I said,
you asked Mrs.
please.
West?
I don't need her resume. I already know her credentials. But nobody knows your credentials, and nobody knows Joe's because they're new. But the public knows our credentials.
The public knows my credentials as well. That's why they elected me to this position.
Right.
You may not
they don't
like
know
that.
The credentials.
No, I'm sorry. Don't interrupt. I was elected just as you were, and I deserve the same respect.
This is way off topic. Roll call, please.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
No.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mrs. West?
No.
Mr. Gillingham?
No.
Motion passes.
Okay.
Now, this is for the motion to appoint Mr. Aragona.
No, he's already on.
Already done.
So all three of you are on.
That was it? I thought you said I had to read
no.
that.
No, the motion was for three
okay.
of you. Item 18, sale of surplus item, 2012 combination sewer truck cleaner.
Dear members of the board, attached you will find a proposal from Chesterfield Township to purchase the 2012 VACCON brand 7 cubic yard capacity combination sewer cleaning truck. The board had previously approved the purchase of a new combination sewer cleaning truck as part of this fiscal year budget. However, to accommodate the purchase of a new cleaning truck, the old truck needed to be sold. Unfortunately, the qualified combination sewer cleaning truck vendors only offered a scant $40,000 as a trade-in value for the 2012 truck. But at the onset of this process, Clinton Township was made aware of the fact that Chesterfield Township was in need of a combination sewer cleaning truck. Staff contacted the Chesterfield Township Water Department and informed them that the Clinton Township truck would need to be sold at a value of double the amount offered through a trade-in, or in other words, $80,000. Chesterfield Township staff then proceeded to visit Clinton Township and performed a thorough examination of the truck. In accordance with Township sale of surplus property policy, we recommend the sale of the 2012 VACCON brand 7 cubic yard capacity combination sewer cleaning truck to Chesterfield Township for $80,000. If you have any questions, please do not hesitate to ask. Sincerely, Mary Bednar, Director of Public Services.
Thank you. Are there any comments or questions from the board? The motion is open. The floor is open for a motion. I'll make the motion that we approve the sale to Chesterfield for $80,000, subject to their board approval. It's next week.
Are we throwing in the as is?
As is.
As is. Okay.
The nice thing about having it in a neighboring community is we oftentimes share equipment, and should we be needing to borrow this back, we would have that ability, and we've been promised that. Roll call, please.
Mr. Cannon.
Yes.
Mr. Pearl.
Yes.
Mr. Aragona.
Yes.
Mr. Keyes.
Yes.
Mrs. West.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Item 18, request authorization to attend a conference.
Dear board members, attached to this letter, please find an authorization to attend conference for my deputy, Elizabeth Vogel. This is so she may attend the Michigan Association of Planning's 2017 annual conference. This is not a budgeted item. I have asked Elizabeth to take an active role working with our planning department and Macomb County Planning and Economic Development regarding the redevelopment of Groesbeck Highway. For over a year, Elizabeth has coordinated with municipalities along the corridor and attended meetings with local and county officials. We are now beta testing the new Groesbeck Corridor assessment tool created by the county. In addition, she has been active assisting the Marijuana Ordinance Exploratory Committee for several months, which involves serious discussion of planning and zoning requirements. This conference has a robust lineup of speakers on a variety of relevant subjects that will be useful for Elizabeth's professional growth and training in the area of planning and economic development. I apologize that this is an add-on item, but our office was made aware of the conference after the agenda deadline. In addition, prices and fees associated with the conference increased significantly after August 21st. Therefore, it was appropriate to place on the August 14th agenda for your consideration. Sincerely, Robert Cannon, Supervisor.
Are there any comments or questions?
Motion to approve.
Thank you. Seconded by Mr. Pearl. Roll call, please.
Mr. Gilliam.
Mr. Keyes.
I'm sorry, Mr. Keyes.
Just a quick question, not in regards to something that was referenced in the letter, the Marijuana Committee. I know that Mr. Pearl had asked in the past when we formed the committee that the trustees receive updates and minutes on those meetings. It sounds like that there's been some progress, and I was hoping that maybe those documents could actually be forwarded to us.
They will be, and I have a public service announcement at the end of the meeting, too.
Thank you.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Approval of the minutes of the July 24th regular Township Board meeting.
I'm sorry. You were the first one.
Okay.
So moved.
Supported by Mr. Pearl. Roll call, please.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. Approval of the bills?
So moved.
Mr. Pearl, is there a second?
Support.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Gilliam?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer, yes. Motion passes.
Thank you. And there are no public comments, but I do have one public service announcement. On the 29th of this month, we will be having a special meeting for the public to give input to the entire Township Board. And we will have that meeting at 6:30 p.m., and the meeting will be held. Mrs. Meltzer, could you help me with the room and the location?
The location is I don't know the real room number, but it's the Extension Center at the Macomb Community
Extension.
College.
Extension, and we will get that information out as many different ways as we possibly can. Mr. Dolan?
Yes, I'm actually assisting in preparing an announcement that will go in the paper. And by way of clarification, there will be three individuals presenting information. Each person will speak about 15 minutes. Persons can come to the meeting and can speak. They have up to 3 minutes is what we're talking about now as far as the time limit for speaking. This is not a township board meeting. Board members are not going to sit as a board at the meeting. It's simply an opportunity to hear some speakers on the subject and in a public setting to offer your comments. Board members will be potentially present to hear what's said, but they're not there serving in their function as a township board member at a board meeting. So that's the format that we're utilizing, and it's to gain some additional information if you're interested, and also to express your views on the topic.
Mr. Dolan answered my question. I just wanted to make sure that every board member could attend and whether
or not. Oh, no. I'm presuming we're going to sit just like this, Mr. Dolan.
No.
No, you can well, basically, the important thing is we're not scheduling it as a board meeting. So that means that the board cannot engage in any decision making and cannot engage in any deliberation. If you choose to do that, which you still can, you have to format it as an actual board meeting.
No, it's not a board meeting. It's a public comment.
Right. We just want to hear from the public.
The only thing I will add to that is I will be having someone hand out cards for people to fill out so that we can get names and addresses of those who speak.
Well, sure, that's
so
fine.
That we know who they represent and where they're from. Okay. That is the end of it. So a motion to adjourn is in order.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Support.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Keyes?
Yes.
Mrs. West?
Yes.
Mr. Aragona?
Yes.
Mr. Pearl?
Yes.
Mr. Cannon?
Yes.
Mr. Gillingham?
Yes.
Mrs. Meltzer? Yes.
Thank you. Meeting adjourned.